Yes, students, hope you guys have gone through the previous classes. Let's continue our discussion on various topics on econometrics. Although this lecture series is prepared for the postgraduate students of economics of Kannur University, this would also be helpful to all those students who want to get some clarity on the topics discussed here. Today, we are going to discuss an important and interesting topic in econometrics, the simultaneous equation models. I have divided my entire discussion on simultaneous equation models into four parts. All these four sections will be available to you in four different PowerPoint videos. In the first part, we discuss the meaning, definition, and nature of simultaneous equation models, some common examples of simultaneous equation models, and finally, we discuss simultaneity problem or the problem of simultaneous equation bias. In the second part, we will go behind the identification problem relating to the simultaneous equation models. In this section, we will also have a look at the different types of variables entering into the model. Also, we will see the structural equations, reduced form equations and their coefficients. We will examine the equation under consideration is identified, unidentified or underidentified. If it is identified, we examine whether it is exactly identified or over-identified. In the third section, we will examine the rules of identification. Here we will go through the order conditions and rank conditions of identifiability. We also will have a look at the test of simultaneity and the test of exogeneity in this section. In the fourth and final part of our lecture on simultaneous equation models, we look at the different methods for estimating models with the simultaneity problem. We discuss the recursive models, the method of indirect least squares, and the method of two-stage least squares during this session. All these parts of the lecture will be available to you in separate video presentations. As mentioned above, in the first two parts, we discuss the meaning and nature of simultaneous equation models, examples of simultaneous equation models, and the problem of simultaneous equation bias. The major reference text I used for this lecture is the Basic Econometrics written by Damodar Gujarati. Clarifications on some topics were made using some internet sources too. One important precondition for understanding this lecture is to have at least a minimum knowledge on the basics of regression methodology. Therefore, I request you to go through the previous topics before getting into this session. Let us recall the structure of a single equation regression model, where one variable, that is the dependent variable y, is expressed as a linear function of one or more other variable or the explanatory variables, or simply we call them as x variables. In such models, we usually make an implicit assumption, that is the cause and effect relationship between y and the explanatory variable x is unidirectional. The explanatory variable are the cause and the dependent variable is the effect. However, there are some other situations where there is a two-way flow of influence among the economic variables. That is, one economic variable affects another economic variable and is in turn affected by the same variable. There is a mutual influence among them. Consider an example. If we regress demand for money on the rate of interest, here demand for money is the dependent variable and the rate of interest is the explanatory variable. The single equation regression methodology implicitly assume that the explanatory variable is fixed or it is assumed to be given. In our example, the rate of interest is assumed to be fixed. That is, it may be given by the RB. Now, with this implicit assumption, the single equation regression methodology tries to find out the response of money demanded to the changes in the level of interest rate. But what happens if the rate of interest depends on the demand for money? Here, we need to consider two equations. One relating to demand for money to rate of interest, and another relating to rate of interest to demand for money. That is, one relating to M to R and another relating to R to M. This is an example of simultaneous equation model. That is, models which exhibit simultaneity, or models in which there is more than one regression equation, one for each interdependent variable. In single equation models, that is, models in which there was a single dependent variable y and one or more explanatory variable or the x variables, our emphasis was on estimating or predicting the average value of y conditional upon the fixed values of the x variables. The cause and effect relationship in such models therefore ran from the x variable to the y. But in many situations, y is determined by the x variables and some of the x variables are in turn determined by the y. In short, there is a two-way or simultaneous relationship between y and the x variables, or may between y and some of the x variables. This is a problem for us because this phenomena makes the distinction between dependent and explanatory variables is of a dubious value. In such models, where there is more than one equation, one for each of the mutually or jointly dependent or endogenous variables, what is the difference between endogenous and exogenous variable in the context of simultaneous equation models? In the context of simultaneous equation models, the jointly dependent variables are called endogenous variable, and the variables that are truly non-stochastic are called the exogenous or predetermined variables. We will come to these things later. In the simultaneous equation models, it is not advisable to estimate the parameters of a single equation without considering of the information provided by other equations in the system. One of the crucial assumptions of OLS method is that the explanatory variables or the x variables are either non-stochastic, or if they are stochastic, they are at least distributed independently of the stochastic disturbance term. That is, they do not have any correlation with the disturbance term or error term. If neither of these conditions is met, then the least square estimators are not only biased but also inconsistent asymptotically. That is, as the sample size increases indefinitely, the estimators do not converge to their true population values. Look at the following hypothetical system of equations. Here we have two equations. In the first equation, y1 is a function of y2 and x1. And in the second equation, y2 is a function of y1 and x1. Thus, y1 and y2 are mutually dependent or endogenous variables, and x1 is the only predetermined or exogenous variables. Where u1 and u2 are the stochastic disturbance terms, and the variable y1 and y2 are also both stochastic. We have seen that one among the crucial assumptions required for applying OLS is the explanatory variables are non-stochastic, and even if they are stochastic, they should be distributed independently of the error terms. But here, in our example, the variables y1 and y2 are not only stochastic but also not distributed independently of the error terms. The stochastic explanatory variables y2 in equation 1 is not distributed independently of u1, and the stochastic explanatory variable y1 in equation 2 is not distributed independently of U2. Application of the classical Euler's to these equations individually will lead to inconsistent estimate. Therefore, we cannot do the ordinary least square method here. Now let's turn our attention to find out some common examples from economics. The demand and supply model is a classic example of such simultaneous relationship. As is well known, the price of a commodity and the quantity of the commodity finally sold are determined by the intersection of the demand and supply function for that commodity. Thus, assuming for simplicity that the demand and supply curves are linear and adding the stochastic disturbance terms U1 and U2, we may write the empirical demand and supply function as demand function is equal to alpha 0 plus alpha 1 pt plus U1 and supply function is equal to beta 0 plus beta 1 pt plus U2, and for equilibrium the quantity demanded is equal to quantity supplied. Theoretically, alpha 1, that is the slope of the demand function, is expected to be negative. Hence, we have downward sloping demand curve, and beta 1, the slope of the supply function, is expected to be positive. Hence, we have upward sloping supply curve. Here, P and Q are jointly dependent variable. If, for example, the error term U1 in equation 1 changes because of the changes in other variables affecting the quantity demanded, such as income of the consumer, wealth of the consumer, and taste and preferences of the consumer, etc. The demand curve will shift upward if U1 is positive and downward if U1 is negative. These shifts are shown in the figure here. As the figure shows, a shift in the demand curve changes both price and quantity demanded. Similarly, a change in the error term in the supply function U2 may be due to because of strikes, weather changes, import or export restrictions, etc. That will also lead a shift in supply curve. Here also, it affects both price and quantity demanded. Because of this simultaneous dependence between the quantity demanded and price, U1 and PT in equation 1 and U2 and PT in equation 2 cannot be independent. Therefore, a regression of Q on P would violate an important assumption of the classical linear regression model, namely the assumption of no correlation between the explanatory variables and the disturbance term. Now, we do have another example here. Consider the simple Keynesian model of income determination. We have a stochastic consumption function and a national income identity here. The consumption function Ct is equal to beta 0 plus beta 1 yt plus ut, and the income identity yt is equal to Ct plus it. It is also equal to st. Where we know that the C is the consumption expenditure, Y is income, I is the investment, and that is assumed to be exogenously given, and S savings, U is the stochastic disturbance terms, beta 0 and beta 1 are the parameters, the intercept parameter and the slope parameters of the consumption function, and the parameter beta 1 is also known as the marginal propensity to consume. From economic theory, we know that the MPC is expected to lie in between 0 and 1. From the figure, it can be seen that the C and Y are interdependent, and YT is not expected to be independent of the disturbance term, because when UT shifts, because of a variety of factors included in the error term, when UT shifts, then the consumption function also shifts, which in turn affects YT. So, when UT shifts, CT also changes, then when CT changes, then YT also changes. Therefore, the classical least squares method is inapplicable. If applied, the estimators thus obtained will be inconsistent. Let's see another example here. The wage price models contributed by A.W. Phillips. He contributed a famous curve known as the Phillips curve, which represents the relationship between the rate of inflation and the unemployment rate. He made a number of contributions to the growth of the theory of macroeconomics. His study of wage inflation and unemployment in the UK, United Kingdom, from 1861 to 1957 is a milestone in the development of macroeconomics. Phillips found a consistent inverse relationship, that is, when unemployment was high, wages increased slowly. When unemployment was low, wages rose swiftly. Phillips curve represents the average relationship between unemployment and wage behavior over the business cycle. Let us express the Phillips model of money, wage and price determination with the following pairs of equations. The rate of change in money wages is equal to alpha 0 plus alpha 1 into the unemployment rate plus alpha 2 into rate of change in prices plus u1. And the second equation is the rate of change in prices is equal to beta 0 into beta 0 plus beta 1 into the rate of change in money wage rate plus beta 2 into the rate of change in cost of capital plus beta 3 into the rate of change in price of imported raw materials plus u2. So we have u1 and u2 are the stochastic disturbance terms. Since the price variable p enters into the wage equation and the wage variable w enters into the price equation, the two variables are jointly dependent. Therefore, these stochastic explanatory variables are expected to be correlated with the relevant stochastic disturbances. Once again, the classical OLS method is inapplicable to estimate the parameters of the two equations individually. From these three examples listed here, we get more clarity on the phenomena of simultaneity. We now know that simultaneity happens when two variables on either side of a model equation influence each other at the same time. Changes in the right-hand side variable are causing changes in the left-hand side variable, and changes in the left-hand side variable are causing changes in the right-hand side variable. Thus, variables on the left-hand and right-hand side are jointly determined. Models with simultaneity are called simultaneous equation models. In social science theory, this model is also known as structural equation models. Before proceeding into our discussion on simultaneity, let us understand the concept of endogeneity. In simple linear regression model, we assume that the independent variables are exogenous. That is, the error terms in the linear regression model are uncorrelated with the independent variables or explanatory variables. This is the exogeneity assumption. Exogeneity implies that each x variable does not depend on the dependent variable y. Rather, y depends on the x's and on u. Since y depends on u, this means that the x variables are assumed to be independent of y and u. Under the exogeneity assumption, the least square estimators derived from the model are biased, unbiased and consistent estimator of true population parameter. Now, if the independent variable or the x variables are not truly independent of u and y, then the estimated regression coefficients are not consistent if we use the OLS method. Those explanatory variables that are not exogenous are called endogenous variables. Therefore, if for whatever reason an explanatory variable xt is correlated with the model residual term ut, then covariance xt ut is not equal to 0, then we can say that xt is said to be an endogenous explanatory variable, and we say the model suffers from the problem of endogeneity. All OLS estimators will be biased and inconsistent in the presence of endogenous regressors. Endogeneity can arise as a result of measurement error, reverse causality, omitted or unobserved variables, omitted selections, lagged dependent variable, etc. So these are the main reasons for the failure of exogeneity. Our discussion is predominantly on the simultaneity problem or reverse causality case. It is the case when explanatory variable is jointly determined with the dependent variable. In other words, X causes Y, but Y also causes X. So we have a second case, omitted variable case, or it is the case of missing regresses which are correlated. This is an important source of endogeneity. For example, consider a multivariate regression model yt is equal to alpha 0 plus alpha 1 xt plus alpha 2 at plus ut. Here we have two explanatory variable xt and at, where at is considered as an unobservable variable with the covariance xt and at are not equal to 0. So there is a correlation between xt and at. Since we cannot observe at, the model we estimate is yt is equal to alpha 0 plus alpha 1 xt plus ut. Now there is a correlation between xt and at. Thus at will appear in the error term ut. Thus the covariance between the explanatory variable xt and the error term is non-zero. This violates the zero conditional mean assumption. The third important reason is that the omitted sample selection. This happens when we select the sample on the basis of something correlated with the residual term ut. For example, if we only look at the workers and exclude non-workers completely from our sample selection, then the latter might have different residual term from the former. Then another reason is that lagged dependent variables. Regression model, particularly time series model, includes a lagged dependent variables in which the error term is serially correlated. Recall our understanding on autocorrelation. We have seen that the estimates obtained by then will be consistent and biased. The lagged dependent variable yt minus 1 thus correlated with the disturbance terms. Now, solving the problem of endogeneity is the real art of econometrics. All sources of endogeneity lead to inconsistent OLS estimation. Ideally, we would eliminate measurement error, introduce omitted or unobserved variables for solving the correlated missing regresses, narrow the generality of interpretation, estimate a system of simultaneous equation, etc. Often, these solutions are not achievable in practice. Reverse causality is also tougher to handle. Thus, the solution is to use an alternative estimation method known as instrumental variables method, or equivalently two-stage least squares method. Now we are coming to the center of our discussion. That is, what happens to the OLS estimators if there is simultaneous equation bias? Simultaneous equation bias is a fundamental problem in many applications of regression analysis in the social sciences. This arises when a right-hand side variable or the explanatory variable is not truly exogenous. That is, the explanatory variable may be correlated with the regression error term or the residual disturbance term. Therefore, ordinary least squares regression applies to a single equation from a system of simultaneous equations will produce biased, systematically wrong parameter estimates. Furthermore, the bias from OLS does not decrease as the sample size increases. The bias will not disappear asymptotically. Estimating parameters from a simultaneous equation model requires some advanced methods, of which the most popular today is two-stage least squares or 2SLS. We will come to it later. The method of least squares may not be applied to estimate a single equation embedded in a system of simultaneous equations if one or more of the explanatory variables are correlated with the disturbance state. For example, in a Keynesian model of income determination, suppose that we want to estimate the parameters of the consumption function Ct is equal to beta 0 plus beta 1 yt plus ut by assuming the usual classical linear regression model assumptions, that is, mean 0, homostochastic variance, and no autocorrelation. So here we can first show that yt and ut in the consumption function are correlated, and then prove that the beta 1 hat is an inconsistent estimator of beta 1, that is the population parameter. To prove that yt and ut are correlated, we proceed as follows. Substitute consumption function Ct is equal to beta 0 plus beta 1 yt plus ut into national income identity, that is yt is equal to ct plus it, to obtain yt is equal to beta 0 plus beta 1 yt plus ut plus it. With some minor calculations as shown in the text box on the right side of this slide, we obtain yt is equal to beta 0 divided by 1 minus beta 1 plus it divided by 1 minus beta 1 plus ut divided by 1 minus beta 1. And the expectation of yt is equal to beta 0 divided by 1 minus beta 1 plus it divided by 1 minus beta 1, since expectation ut is equal to 0 and it is given as exogenous. Therefore, its expected value is it. Subtracting expectation yt from yt results yt minus expectation yt, we get ut divided by 1 minus beta 1. Moreover, since expectation ut is equal to 0, ut minus expectation ut is equal to ut. Hence, the covariance among yt and ut is equal to expectation of ut divided by 1 minus beta 1 into ut. That is equal to expectation of ut square divided by 1 minus beta 1. That is equal to sigma square divided by 1 minus beta 1. Since the sigma square is positive, there is a covariance between y and u. It is bound to be different from 0. As a result, yt and ut are expected to be correlated, which violates the assumption of the classical linear regression model that the disturbances are independent or at least uncorrelated with the explanatory variables. Therefore, the Euler's estimators in this situation are inconsistent. This is the problem of endogeneity. Simultaneity or reverse causality is one among the major causes behind the endogeneity problem. You can recall all those lectures relating to linearity and unbiasedness of the estimators obtained from the Euler's method. We have proved that the estimators are blue, that is, they are the best linear unbiased estimators. Now, if we assume no endogeneity problem and we estimate the consumption function independently, we obtain linear unbiased estimators. Proof of this is given in this slide. Kindly rush through it and recall what we have learned in our lessons relating to the linearity and unbiasedness in the single equation regression models. But now we are confronting with the problem of simultaneity. Hence, our estimators are not consistent. To show that the Euler's estimator beta 1 hat is an inconsistent estimator of beta 1 because of the correlation between yt and ut, we proceed as follows. We know that if beta 1 hat want to be an unbiased estimator of beta 1, we should get beta 1 hat is equal to sigma yt minus y bar into ct minus c bar divided by sigma yt minus y bar whole square. So taking into deviation form, we can write it as sigma small yt into small ct divided by sigma small yt square.
So that is also can be written as sigma small y t into capital y ct divided by sigma small y t square. So the proof of this equation is given in the above slide, in the previous slide. Now substituting the ct consumption function in the equation, last equation, we obtain beta 1 hat is equal to sigma yt into beta 0 plus beta 1 yt plus ut divided by sigma yt square. Now we can write yt divided by sigma yt square as kt. So we introduced this term while studying about the properties of linearity and unbiasedness properties of single equation regression methodology. So you can recall all these things now. So we can represent yt divided by sigma yt square as kt. Therefore, we can write our equation as sigma kt into beta 0 plus beta 1 yt plus ut. So this can also be represented as beta 1 in sigma kt plus beta 0 into sigma kt plus beta 1 into sigma kt yt plus sigma kt ut. So while studying about the linearity and unbiasedness properties of linear regression methodology, we have learned that the properties of kt, that is some of the properties of kt as given in the text box here. Sigma kt is equal to 0, sigma kt square is equal to 1 divided by sigma yt square, and sigma kt yt is equal to 1. So while taking by using these properties, we can write our equation as into equation 7, which is obtained. So in the previous equation, we have seen that sigma kt beta 0 into sigma kt plus beta 1 into sigma kt yt plus sigma kt ut. So first term of the equation becomes 0 because sigma kt is equal to 0. Therefore, first term in the equation 0. The second term in the equation is become beta 1 because sigma kt yt is equal to 1. And the third term, we obtain sigma kt ut. Therefore, finally, we have equation 7, that is beta 1 plus sigma yt ut divided by sigma yt square. If we take expectation of the above equation on both sides, we obtain expectation beta 1 hat is equal to beta 1 plus expectation of sigma yt ut divided by sigma yt square. But it should be clear that unless the term sigma yt ut divided by sigma yt square is 0, beta 1 hat is a biased estimator of beta 1. But we are confronting with the problem of simultaneity, in which the explanatory variable and the error term are correlated. Therefore, the covariance between y and u is non-zero, and hence beta 1 hat may be biased. But we can't jump to a conclusion all of a sudden, since covariance yt ut is a population concept. When we cannot explicitly evaluate the expected value of an estimator, we can turn our attention to its behavior in the large sample. Now, an estimator is said to be consistent if its probability limit, as an acronym of probability limit, we can use the term PLIM. If the probability limit is equal to its true value, population value, therefore, to show that beta 1 hat of the equation beta 1 hat is equal to beta 1 plus sigma yt ut divided by sigma yt square is inconsistent, we must show that its probability limit is not equal to true beta 1. Applying the rules of probability limit, we get probability limit of beta 1 hat is equal to probability limit of beta 1 plus probability limit of covariance between yt and ut divided by variance of yt. So now we divide sigma yt ut and sigma yt square with the total number of observations in the sample. Therefore, we get the sample covariance between yt ut and the sample variance of yt. So Now, the equation can be represented as, that is, probability of limit of beta 1 plus probability limit of the sample covariance between yt and ut divided by the variance of yt. So, in words, this equation can be represented as the probability limit of beta 1 hat is equal to true beta 1 plus the ratio of the probability limit of the sample covariance between y and u to the probability limit of the sample variance of y. Now, as the sample size n increases indefinitely, the sample covariance between y and u to approximate the true population covariance, that is expectation of yt minus expectation yt into expectation of ut minus expectation ut, which is equal to the sigma square divided by 1 minus beta 1. So similarly, when n tends to infinity, the sample variance of y will approximate its population variance, say sigma square y. Therefore, the equation 9 can be written as probability limit of beta 1 hat is equal to beta 1 plus sigma square divided by 1 minus beta 1, that is the sample covariance of yt and ut, divided by sigma square y. So this can be represented as beta 1 plus sigma square divided by 1 minus beta 1 into sigma square divided by sigma square y. Given that the beta 1 is positive and sigma square and sigma square by y are both positive, it is obvious from the equation 10 that the probability limit of beta 1 hat will always be greater than beta 1. That is, beta 1 hat will overestimate the true beta 1. In other words, beta 1 hat is a biased estimator, and the bias will not disappear no matter how large the sample size. Dear friends, we have just concluded the part 1 of our lecture on simultaneous equation models. In this lecture, we have learnt the meaning, nature and definition of simultaneous equation models, understand the problem of simultaneity as part of much bigger problem of endogeneity, and also seeing that our OLS estimators are inconsistent in the presence of simultaneity. So we have 3 more lectures to go to finish our lectures on the topic of simultaneous equation models. Kindly wait for these lectures. If you have any more queries or feedback, kindly contact me. Thank you.